We've been having some seriously beautiful weather here in South Florida lately. So the other day, I grabbed my camera and visited one of my local wetland preserves for some bird photography. Now, as I was leaving, there was this great scene of a bunch of ibises and wood storks flying around and landing on the tree branches as the sun was setting. Now, typically, when I go to these wetland preserves, I really only take one camera and lens. And in this case, it was the Sony A1 II and 100 to 400 millimeter telephoto zoom lens. But the scene in front of me at the time required a much wider focal length to capture everything. So I slung my camera over my shoulder and I grabbed my iPhone 16 Pro Max. I didn't use any special camera apps or anything like that. I just grabbed a handful of Apple ProRAW photos using the 1X lens at 48 megapixels per image. Birds were flying around so often that I was able to get several shots that I instantly knew that I wanted to composite together. And that's what this video is all about. I'm going to walk you through my editing workflow to get the images stylized using Lightroom Desktop, and then I'm going to send those photos to their own layers using Photoshop to combine them, and I'm going to show you just how easy that is. All right, let's dive in. All right, so here we are in Lightroom Desktop, and these are the four photos that I want to work with. So you can see really quickly, iPhone 16 Pro Max, 48 megapixels, and it's a ProRAW DNG file. So what a ProRAW DNG file means is that the image was already processed. It's not like a true like Bayer DNG, which would be 12 megapixels, at least currently. This has been put through Apple's Photonics engine. So it's already had processing done. It's had multiple images at different exposures combined together. Some noise reduction has been applied, some sharpening, some color correction. And so this is kind of Apple's method of giving you a really good looking photo right out of the gate without having to necessarily do anything. Although I love editing my photos, and so I'm still going to edit them. But just to tell you that when you see ProRAW, even though it's a DNG, that doesn't mean that it's like actual sensor data. Some editing has been applied. So let's take a look at the photo here. You can see it's just beautiful, right? Like, I mean, the sun was setting, the conditions were great, and you can see just all these birds are landing in the trees just to bed down for the night. And you can see in this image here, you've got some birds coming in, and then we go over one image. And you can see even just going from one image to the other, there's a little bit of, I'm just hand-holding my iPhone vertically. So there's a little bit of movement, but you can see the birds are coming here, swooping in, more birds, and then just finally this one bird coming in from the right. So I thought it would be fun to just edit one of the photos. I'll walk you through the process. It's pretty straightforward. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. But then I want to show you how you can send these images to Photoshop in order to combine them. And, you know, there are different ways that you can do it. You can manually mask them together, but this technique that I use, it's just foolproof and it really works quite well. So let's start. I'll just start with the first photo in the series. There's no reason why, it's just the first one. And then let's go to edit the photo. Now, one of the first things I usually like to do is crop my image, but because I'm going to combine them together, I'm just going to leave this alone. I'll do the cropping and other things like sharpening and any sort of vignetting. I'll do that at the very, very end. I could try to get a custom white balance. I might, you know, try to put the dropper on one of the birds here. And then let's zoom back out just to see what happened. And yeah, I'm not a fan of it. It cooled off the image to make it a bit more neutral. I don't like it. I'm just going to go back to as shot. I'm okay with this warmth. In fact, I might lean into it a little bit more. Just a little bit like that. I think it looks really good. Now, in terms of tone, just looking at the histogram where everything falls, this looks great. I mean, this is there's no clipped shadows, no blown out highlights, but I will open up the exposure a bit. And I'm also going to add some highlights, drop shadows, and then I'm also going to drop the black point a bit. But I'm not going to touch the white point here. Now, those of you who know me know that I don't use the contrast slider. I think contrast is important, but I don't use a contrast slider. I like to really refine the contrast using the curves panel. So with the curves panel here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to apply a very, very slight S curve. So I'm going to open up the highlights by dropping a dot here. I'll drop another dot down here to deepen the shadows. And then I'm going to drop a dot kind of in the middle for midtones. And so I'm moving it around here. I don't want to get it too hot like this. I'm going to drop it down here, right around there. And then I'm going to add a little bit of gray to the black point just to soften up the contrast a bit. And then on desktop, there is this slider here that's really important that I think gets overlooked. When you add points on this curve, you're also affecting color. And sometimes that gets a bit too punchy. And so that's what this refined saturation slider is for. Like, watch, if I kind of zoom in here, you can see how the colors are getting a bit more muted. Same thing here. Let me go down to the greens. You can see how they get just a little bit more muted, and I prefer that. So I'm going to drop it down to about 32. Now let's go ahead and add a bit of a vibrance boost. I'm going to go a bit strong, and then I'm also going to drop the saturation by about -5, -6. That's fine. I think they balance each other out that way. But now what I want to do is I want to edit the photo locally. So everything we did so far has been global. So what I mean by global is that when I edit these sliders, they affect the entire image. But now what I can do is go to masking here, and I can create masks for specific areas of the photo. So let's start with the sky, of course. You can see everything that's selected is in color, and everything that's not in the mask is marked as grayscale. You can choose that mask by clicking on the ellipse over here, and you can see these different options here. So I think the default one is color overlay, so that basically will put a color over the selection. But I've actually found that this image on black and white makes it easier to visualize. I'm gonna go ahead. First thing I like to do is rename stuff. So I'm gonna call this sky mask. And then one of my favorite sliders for skies, if you've watched any of my videos, is dehaze. I think dehaze just does such a beautiful job of bringing out more character from the sky. You don't wanna go like this. Definitely, definitely not. You know, you just want to bring out a little bit more definition. It brings out a little bit more of the color from the sunset at the bottom of the clouds here. I'm also going to increase texture, but I'm going to decrease clarity. Just because it was getting a bit too crispy in the clouds, which I try to avoid. Now let's go back up here. I'm going to drop the shadows for the sky. I'm also going to drop the exposure just a bit. All right, so we can see here what that mask did just for the sky. It looks great. And now what I want to do is make edits to everything but the sky. And so there's a really nifty shortcut here. If you click on the ellipsis next to the mask, you'll see there is an option here called duplicate and invert mask. So it's going to dupe the mask and then it's going to flip it. So here we go. Now we have basically just the foreground. So let's go ahead and rename this. And I'm going to call this foreground mask. And so for the foreground, what I want to do is kind of the opposite. I'm going to open up the highlights a bit. I'm also going to go to the point curve here, and I'm going to go to the blue channel. Now I'm going to add a little bit of warmth in the highlights. So what I mean by warmth is we're actually adding a little bit of orange. So when I put a dot here, watch, it starts to bring, you see how it kind of warms just the brightest parts of the image? So I'm just going to go right around there, just like that. And again, I talk about the importance of curves like it's such a critical part of my workflow. In fact, I would say curves is probably the most important tool in the editing stack as far as I'm concerned. So at the end of this video, I'll link you to another video that explains everything about the curves panel. All right, let's add a little bit of texture to the foreground and some positive clarity. Remember in the sky, I added negative clarity. And it's getting a bit too, I don't know, contrasty. So I'm going to add negative dehaze. All right, good. That looks good there. Let's go back up here. I'm going to drop those highlights a bit. I'm going to also deepen the shadows right there. Good. Okay, this is looking good. Let's see what the effect of that mask is on the foreground. Yeah, see, just it really does a nice job. It was getting it's a bit too cool here, a bit too contrasty. So adding localized edits to the foreground, I think, just does a really nice job of making the foreground look a little bit more welcoming. So let's go here back to our editing tools. And if I press the backslash key, you can see this is our original photo. And then this is what we did with some quick editing. Now that I've got the kind of baseline edit for one of the images, I need to make sure that those edits are brought over to the rest of the images so we have a cohesive look. And so to do that, I'm going to go to the grid view. And then to the right of the copy edit settings button, there's this gear over here. So I'm going to click this, and this allows me to select specifically what I want to add to the clipboard. So I'm going to drop down over here, and I'm going to select modified, and this just selects everything that was edited. You could even see here if I expand masking, both of the masks, the adaptive masks that I created are here. And so I'm going to click on copy. Now I'll select the remaining three images and then just click on Paste Edit Settings. Now, if you have existing edits here, like some masks or something, and you don't want to replace them, you want to merge them, you would click on Merge. But one, I don't want to merge edits. I want to replace everything with the edits from the first image. So I'm going to click on Replace. Now you can see that it's actually applying the adaptive masks and we are done. So watch, if I go through the images here, you can see that they all look the same. All right, so now it's time for us to get the images from Lightroom to Photoshop. And a few things. One, if you're a Lightroom Classic user, everything I show you, you can follow along. You can do everything that I showed you in Classic, so just follow along there. But also, thanks to a recent update to Lightroom Desktop, we now have the ability to send multiple images to a single document on their own layers in Photoshop. And so that's what we're going to do right now. So I'm going to go to the grid view here, and I'm going to select all four images. I'm going to right-click, then go to Edit in Photoshop, and then you'll want this third option here called Open as Layers in Photoshop. And you'll see when we go to Photoshop over here that all four of these images are being placed into a single document on their own layers, which is critical. All right, so here, just to show you, as I start toggling layers off, they're all here. But as I turn the layers back on, you can see how the images are not perfectly aligned because I was hand-holding the iPhone. And so just kind of, you know, little micro shakes between frames. So the first thing we need to do is make sure that all of these layers are aligned. Now, if you followed one of my other tutorials where I show you how you can focus stack using Photoshop, this will be very familiar because the technique is essentially the same, except with focus stacking, we are combining multiple images so that each of the different planes of focus are visible and sharp. And in this situation, what we're doing is we're using this technique to just combine different elements from multiple layers. So again, the first thing we want to make sure of is that each of these images are aligned. So I'm going to select them. I'm then going to go to the Edit menu, and I'm going to select Auto Align Layers. Auto is fine for the projection. It works really, really good. So I'm going to click on OK. Let me just zoom out a bit here. And now we've got the images aligned here. So watch, if I turn these layers off, you see how the core parts of the image here are aligned. Now what we need to do is actually blend the layers together. So let's go back to Edit and we'll select Auto Blend Layers. Now here, what you'll want to make sure of is that Stack Images is selected. You can see kind of that little icon here of multiple images combined into one. And then I also enabled these two options here, the Seamless Tones and Colors and Content Aware Fill Transparent Areas, which we have some here. So let's go ahead and click on OK. And so now you can see we have this merged layer here. You can see I can hide the four layers underneath and it doesn't affect anything. Also, that Content Aware tool did a great job of filling in those transparent areas, which is great. And it just looks like a fun image. You've got all of the contents from all four of the layers combined seamlessly. Like here are the birds that were flying in from the back in that first layer. And this was the second layer, you know, third layer, and then that one bird here. But also the best part is that it also combined down here the reflections of the birds that were over here in the water. I mean, that's really important and I love it. And so now what I want to do is bring this back into Lightroom just so we could finish things up. And here's the thing. You could use the remove tool here in Photoshop. If you want to get rid of some of these birds or anything, like maybe they're too many, you can do that here. But to be honest, I'd rather just get the image as is from Photoshop into Lightroom, because Lightroom has really powerful generative remove tools. And so I'll just do that over there. This way I have kind of the original photo as it was from Photoshop, and I'll just bring it over to Lightroom. So to do that, it's not enough to just go to File and then Save. What you have to do is save and also close the document, because once you close it, that's kind of the signal to Lightroom to bring it back in. So for me, I just go to Close, and then I select Save. That's going to save the document and then close it. And so watch, once this document is saved, it closes and we go back to Lightroom, and you can see on the top left there, it says Import from Photoshop. There is our TIFF file, and it's going to start syncing to the cloud, which you can see right over here. It's syncing one item. All right, so Now we've got our composited photo. And again, like I said, if you want, you can go to the remove tools here, enable generative AI, and like, you know, if you want to remove that bird there, you can. So it's gone. But to be honest, like I actually want to keep it. Like I want everything here. I think it looks like a really fun photo. And so to wrap things up in terms of editing, what I'll do is I'll go down here. I'm going to add a little bit of a blue primary saturation boost. I kind of forgot to do that in the first image. I love using this. And I've got a video all about the color calibration panel. So I'll put a card right here for that. Definitely check it out. And then let's go ahead. We'll add a post-crop vignette here. Kind of draw the eye towards the center of the frame here. That looks really nice. And then let's add some sharpening. So I'm going to zoom in over here to something that I know is sharp and in focus. I'll press and hold on the Option or Alt key while dragging on the amount slider. This converts the image to grayscale, which makes it easier to see. Like if I go here, you see how everything gets super crunchy. And so I don't want that. I just want a little bit of sharpening, but also I want to remove sharpening from areas where it's not needed using the masking slider. So I'm going to press and hold on the Option or Alt key while dragging on that. And basically I just want the outlines of things like a pencil sketch. So something like that. That way I know that sharpening is being applied to the edges of things and it's being removed from areas where it's kind of smooth and flat where you don't want sharpening. See, I love it. Even this little looks like a heron right there. But if I hit the backslash key, again, this is the photo from Photoshop. So we already had most of our edits applied, but we just applied some vignette and sharpening effects here. And if I go to grid view here, again, you can see we took the four images and combined them into this one over here. And I just think it's a lot of fun. And so I kind of wanted to show you, let's say you are out and you're taking photos in sequence and you want to combine them together. You don't have to worry about doing all sorts of painstaking masking. You certainly could. You can open those images up in their own layers in Photoshop and mask them manually. But I find that auto align and auto blend technique is, it's magical. It works really, really well. Now, if you are excited about this, like you want to kind of develop your landscape editing techniques, I do have a course called Lightroom Landscapes, and I built this course almost more for myself because over the years, I learned the importance of having a repeatable and kind of methodical process to how you approach landscape photography editing, in this case, using Lightroom. So I'll leave a link to it below if you want to learn more. It's a really great course, and I'm sure it's going to help you improve your landscape photo editing using Lightroom and Photoshop. With that, I mentioned how I do have a video all about the curves panel. But it's one of Lightroom's most powerful tools. Of course, if you found this video helpful, a thumbs up is greatly appreciated. And please do click on the subscribe and bell icons to get notified of the next video. Thanks a lot, everyone.